grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit.
Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will
through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Let us pray together.
Everybody falls sometimes, gotta find the strength to rise from the ashes and make a new beginning. Anyone can feel the ache, you think it's more than you can take, but you're stronger, stronger than you know. Don't you give up now, the sun will soon be shining. You've got to face the clouds to find the silver lining. I've seen dreams that move the mountains, hope that doesn't ever end, even when the sky is falling. I've seen miracles just happen, silent prayers get answered, broken hearts become brand new. That's what faith can do. It doesn't matter what you've heard, impossible is not a word, it's just a reason for someone not to try. And everybody's scared to death when they decide to take that step out on the water. It'll be alright, 'cause life is so much more than what your eyes are seeing. You will find your way if you keep believing. I've seen dreams that move the mountains, hope that doesn't ever end, even when the sky is falling. I've seen miracles just happen, silent prayers get answered, broken hearts become brand new. That's what faith can do. That's what faith can do. That's what faith can do.
Good morning and welcome to worship. It's good to have you here this morning, this joint worship service with Salem, Catonsville, and Faith Cockeysville. My name is David Asendorf, and I'm joined by Pastor Sarah Garrett Cray from Salem and Pastor Micah Cray from Cockeysville, from Faith Cockeysville. A special warm welcome to all our visitors, especially first-time folks who may be joining us today. Thank you. It's great to have you here. A few announcements for the Salem community. The monthly newsletter, The Monarch, is available online. You can go and take a look at that on the Salem website. Yesterday, at our 5 p.m. Saturday worship service, we confirmed Noah Reichert, and we also celebrated the First Communion for Brooke Proia. So that was a wonderful celebration yesterday. Just remind you of our fellowship groups that meet on Tuesday and Wednesday, and our men's prayer breakfast that meets on Wednesday morning at 8. You can get all of the information about those meetings on our Salem website and also the Salem Midweek congregational email. Again, thank you. It's great to have you here this morning.
Good morning. I am Pastor Micah Cray. It is a delight to be with you all. Just a few announcements for the faith community. You should have received in the mail by now, hopefully, your ballot for the live streaming equipment that we are voting on. We are collecting these ballots back by November 15th, either by mail or dropping them off at Faith's building. You can drop them off in the mailbox or deliver them on Sunday mornings while we have the church open, and we'll happily receive those ballots. We are hoping they will all be back by November 15th so that we can move forward in the process. If you have any questions about the live streaming equipment, about the vote, please do not hesitate to contact myself or any of the members of council, and we would happily talk to you about the process that we are undergoing. But please fill out those ballots and return them by November 15th. Also, we'd love to invite you to our Wednesday evening fellowship hour at 6:30 on Zoom, where we pray with one another and we check in with one another. We have had some great meetings recently, and we would love to have you join us Wednesdays at 6:30 on Zoom. We are just so grateful that you are worshiping with us this day. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship as we begin with our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose image we are made, who claims us and calls us beloved. Amen. Amen.
Holy One, we confess that we are not awake for you. We are not faithful in using your gifts. We forget the least of our siblings. We do not see your beautiful image in one another. We are infected by sin that divides your beloved community. Open our hearts to your coming. Open our eyes to see you in our neighbor. Open our hands to serve your creation. Amen.
Beloved, we are God's children, and Jesus, our beloved, opens the door to us. Through Jesus, you are forgiven. By Jesus, you are welcome. In Jesus, you are called to rejoice. Let us live in the promises prepared for us from the foundation of the world. Amen.
Our gathering hymn is Open Up the Heavens.
Open up.
Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Thank you, Daddy.
Almighty God, gracious Lord, we thank you that your Holy Spirit renews the church in every age. Pour out your Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep them steadfast in your word. Protect and comfort them in times of trial, defend them against all enemies of the gospel, and bestow on the church your saving peace, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Then we can go down.
A reading from Amos. Alas, for you who desire the day of the Lord. Why do you want the day of the Lord? It is darkness, not light, as if someone fled from a lion and was met by a bear, or went into the house and rested a hand against the wall and was bitten by a snake. Is not the day of the Lord darkness, not light, and gloom with no brightness in it? I hate, I despise your festivals, and I take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Even though you offer me your burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them. And the offerings of well-being of your fatted animals I will not look upon. Take away from me the noise of your songs. I will not listen to the melody of your harps. But let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. Word of God, word of life, thanks be to God.
Let us recite Psalm 70 responsibly. Be pleased, O God, to deliver me. O Lord, make haste to help me. Let those who seek my life be put to shame and confounded. Let those who take pleasure in my misfortune draw back and be disgraced. Let those who say to me, aha, and gloat over me, turn back because of their shame. Let all who seek you rejoice and be glad in you. Let those who love your salvation say forever, great is the Lord. But as for me, I am poor and needy. Come to me quickly, O God. You are my helper and my deliverer. O Lord, do not tarry.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 25th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to the disciples, then the kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a shout, look, here is the bridegroom, come out to meet him. Then all those bridesmaids got up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out. But the wise replied, no, there will not be enough for you and for us. You had better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves. And while they went to buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came also, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he replied, truly, I tell you, I do not know you. Keep awake, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Thank you. a story about why it's important to be prepared. Think about all the things that you do on a daily basis to get prepared for the day. Brushing our teeth, getting dressed, making our beds, having breakfast. The lesson today points out the importance of being prepared and gathering the things that you need in order to be prepared. So, for example, Jimmy on Sunday, is gonna need all of these things to get prepared for lacrosse. Veronica is going to need this to get prepared for something. Do you know what that is? School. It's kind of weird that we need a computer to get prepared for school. A lot different than a backpack and a lunchbox, right? And our family, minus me, needs these things to get prepared for camping. I only glamp. So the Bible lesson today talked about 10 bridesmaids who were preparing for a wedding celebration, but only 5 of them were actually prepared. 5 of them didn't think through all the things that they needed. They forgot the extra oil and they missed out. Can you think of a time when you didn't think through all the things that you needed? Imagine if we went camping and didn't have a light. Once it gets dark, it's really hard to find your way. So you need to think through and be prepared. So why would Jesus tell us this story? He told us this story to point out that there are ways that we can also prepare ourselves to share the news of God. We can prepare our minds by reading our Bible stories during the week and learning about Jesus and all of his teachings. We can prepare our hearts by thinking through those stories and talking to our families about how we can live a more faithful life. We can prepare our mouths by sharing those stories, telling others about what we've learned, and by using kind words when we're talking to other people. And we can prepare our hands by completing random acts of kindness, ways to just show other people that we love them and we care about them, to share God's love with them as well. Think about the ways that you can prepare yourself to share God's love with your family, your friends, and through the things that you do in your life. Let's pray. Dear God, we want to be prepared to follow you at all times in our lives. Please give us the skills and the tools that we need to be prepared. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Have a great week.
My dad used to tell this story about a family friend of ours named Mike. Sometimes I called him Uncle Mike. My dad, Uncle Mike, and a few other friends were eating dinner at one of those restaurants where they give you a bucket of peanuts before your meal, and you can just toss the shells on the floor. You know, the kind of place where every step you take crunches. My dad and his friends were seated in a large booth, and around the same time, a family of 3 was seated just on the other side of them, with a wooden partition separating their side-by-side booths. It was a couple of parents and what sounded like a little boy around age 5 or 6, judging by the sound of his voice. The little boy was just on the other side of the partition from Uncle Mike, and it soon became evident that this boy had found a very amusing game to play. Every 30 seconds or so, a peanut shell would come flying over the partition right into Uncle Mike's lap. It happened once, and it was amusing to Mike and my dad and their friends, but then it continued. Every minute or so, another peanut shell, plop, right into Mike's sweet tea. Plop, one landed in his lap, or smack, hitting him right in the head. Although the boy couldn't see over the partition, it was clear by the sound of his giggling that he knew there were people on the other side. My dad and his friends asked Mike why he didn't pop his head over and tell the boy to cut it out, as it was clear that his parents either didn't notice or didn't care, and the behavior was starting to be both annoying and disruptive to their meal. But Uncle Mike just shrugged it off, brushing the peanut shells off of his lap and onto the floor, shelling and eating his own peanuts in the meantime in a leisurely fashion, despite the near constant bombardment. Finally, at the end of their meal, my dad and his friends had paid their bills and were getting ready to go, still noticing a rogue peanut shell coming over every now and again, although it was a little less frequent. Uncle Mike had finished his meal and had also amassed a sizable pile of his own peanut shells, which he dumped over the partition all at once before getting up to leave. A stunned silence was all that came from the other side. You could say that Uncle Mike had been playing the long game. There's a lot to unpack in the parable found in this week's gospel text, but I think what sticks out to me the most is that the gospel writer is speaking to a community that is learning how to play the long game in their lives of faith. See, Matthew's gospel was not written until around 80 to 90 CE, so around 50 or 60 years after the death and resurrection of Jesus. And this particular parable about 10 bridesmaids who need to be alert and ready for the coming bridegroom is found only in the Gospel of Matthew, not Mark, not Luke, not John, only in Matthew, which means it might have been added to make a point specifically to the Jewish and Christian Jesus followers of Matthew's time, who are now 5 decades removed from the life of Jesus. After Christ's resurrection, he appeared multiple times to his disciples, promising that he would return. And on that day, the entire world would be reconciled to God's self, restored and made whole. We have a lot of names for that: Judgment Day, the Eschaton, the last days, the second coming of Christ. As a Christian community, we regularly proclaim the words, "Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again." And for us, who are more than 2,000 years removed from the time Jesus walked the earth, it's pretty normal and comfortable to live in the ambiguity of that, not knowing when exactly it will happen, but being pretty sure that it won't be tomorrow. But imagine that you are a member of the early Christian community. Perhaps you were there when Jesus was crucified. Perhaps you heard from a friend of a friend that a couple of women saw the risen Christ with their own eyes. Perhaps you heard Christ's promise to return and you are ready for it to happen at any moment. Your bags are packed and you're ready to go, and then it doesn't happen. And you wait for days, for years, for decades. Perhaps the author of Matthew's gospel saw the community around him growing weary of waiting and losing patience and hope. And so he includes this parable about a group of bridesmaids waiting for the arrival of the groom. Some of them are so eager, so caught up, so ready for the moment that they are waiting for, the arrival of the groom, that they dash out of the house with their lamps and only the oil that is in them. But some of them take the long view, imagining that there could be delays or disruptions, and they take some extra oil just in case. And it turns out they need it, because there is indeed a delay. The bridegroom doesn't arrive on time as expected. Perhaps this parable was a pastoral word that followers of Jesus who longed for his imminent return only to wait and wait and wait, needed to hear. To remind them to keep the faith and to play the long game and keep their eyes on the horizon. I wonder if we too don't need that reminder these days. As I wrote this on Wednesday night and as I preach this on Thursday morning, I do not know who our president will be for the next 4 years. We've all been eagerly anticipating this election result, rushing towards its arrival so that we can just know what the future holds. But perhaps we, like the early Christian community, need to remember that this is a long game. That regardless of the outcome of this election, there is and will always be work for us to do in the public squares of our lives. That the results of this election will not magically solve all our nation's problems or answer all of our questions. And so even after a winner is declared, we will continue to act and pray and vote in other elections and make our voices heard, recognizing that these individual wins and losses are not the end goal for us. That for us, as Christians who live in America, the end goal is the day that the prophet Amos envisions from our first reading today, when the dams of sin and injustice crumble entirely and justice rolls down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream, a healing and restoring rush of baptismal waters, not just for our nation, but for all of creation. Our civic engagement is only one piece of the long game. Another prophet, Micah, reminds us, God has told you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? But to do justice, and to love kindness, and to walk humbly with God. That is our long game plan, not just during election years, not just when it's convenient or popular or fashionable, but every day, at every opportunity, even when we've failed, we continue to get up and try again with Jesus as our guide. As Christians, we play the long game, keeping our scope broad, remembering that it's not just about the instant gratification of the moment, but also about keeping one eye on the horizon as we look for the reign of God to come. We're playing the long game, too, in this season of pandemic. We wear our masks, we maintain distance, we forgo singing in groups and gatherings with our families, we worship online and only in small groups in person. My mom and dad were supposed to come up and stay with Micah and I for Thanksgiving, and we had a phone call this week and canceled with them because if we all believe that our family is the exception to this virus, I'm afraid some of us are going to be in a world of hurt after the holidays. So we've made the painful decision that we won't gather in person now so that when we do gather in the future, when it's safer to do so, no one is missing around the table. We play a long game and keep a long view, recognizing that some sacrifices now might just keep others safe in the future. At our Saturday evening service, Noah Reichert was confirmed and Brooke Proya received her first communion. Noah had to write a statement of faith as part of his confirmation, and in his faith statement, he wrote that he has learned, quote, what it means to be part of a church and what my next step on my spiritual journey is. See, Noah articulated what I think we sometimes lose sight of as a church, that confirmation is not a graduation, not a way of saying, great, I learned the stuff and now I am done. I can vote in congregational elections. No, confirmation is just another piece of the long game, part of being within a Christian community where we continue on our journey of spiritual growth and understanding, giving of our time and our talents in service to God and our neighbors, worshiping together regularly, whether online or in person, and listening for the guidance of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Brooke, too, encountered a first. She received her first communion last night, recognizing that it will be but the first of hundreds in her life. And in perhaps the ultimate divine image of the long game, when Brooke communes on Saturday evening, when our Salem community communes online together on the first Wednesday of the month, when the faith community gathers for their monthly communion service, every time that happens, we commune with all the saints who have gone before us, of every time and every place, and all the saints who will come after us, united across time and space by the grace of Christ's very self. Because taking the long view doesn't mean that we sit around just twiddling our thumbs, awaiting some far-off magical moment when Christ will return. Taking the long view and being prepared for Christ means that we are actively preparing for and experiencing innumerable moments of the inbreaking of Christ's presence with us in our lives every day, right here and right now. We are aware that God's kingdom is both here and now and a distant future that we cannot fully comprehend, already and not yet. And so we pray each week, God's kingdom come, God's will be done on earth as it is in heaven, and we do what we can little by little to make earth a little more like the kingdom of heaven every day, with justice and mercy, and humility, and truth-telling, and worship, and care for our neighbors, for creation, and for the most vulnerable among us. As Pastor Micah preached from Revelation last week, one day God will make all things new. In the meantime, we play a long game, appreciating the glimpses of what is to come every time we experience love in action, humble service, the deepening of relationships, and the beauty of worship in our everyday lives. The redemption and restoration of the whole world may not happen in our lifetime, and the redemption and restoration of the whole world will not come with the results of an election. But make no mistake, God's kingdom is breaking into our world little by little, all the time. So keep one foot in the present, dear church. Do the best you can here and now with God's help. But don't forget to pack a little extra oil and collect those peanut shells with an eye toward the future, because Christ has died. Christ is risen, and Christ will come again to make all things new. Amen.
Our hymn of the day is Wake, Awake, for Night is Flying.
Oh,
Loving God, be with your church. Guide us through times of division and turmoil. Help us to keep an eye on the horizon and to remember that this is a long game. Help us to bring your kingdom to earth little by little every day, but to remember that ultimately it is you and you alone who will make all things new. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Holy Creator, surprise and delight us with the beauty of the world you have made. Bless the work of landscapers, architects, and artists whose work invites us into harmonious living with your creation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, we pray for unity and peace in our nation. May we acknowledge that there is so much more that binds us together than separates us. May we never view those who differ from us as enemies. Guide our nation into the path of justice and peace. We ask your blessing upon all of our people. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, this weekend we celebrate our veterans, give thanks for their faithful service to our nation. May a grateful nation remember and take good care of our disabled veterans. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy Judge, let justice roll down like waters over this world. Reign over systems of justice throughout our world. Be present in cases where we long for both justice and mercy to prevail. Bring your peace to all places, and especially those places that know conflict. This week we remember the anniversary of the devastation of Kristallnacht, the night of broken glass, and the hatred that led to the atrocities of the Holocaust. May we never forget what took place, and may we never again allow that hatred to overtake us. Inspire us with the courage to speak out and stand against hatred, bigotry, and violence against any and all people in our nation and in our world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Well, Lord, we pray today your healing mercies for all of those who are sick, hospitalized, in rehab, homebound, recovering at home. We pray especially for those who are struggling with COVID-19. We ask that you would lift up all of those who are providing care, especially nurses and physicians, and your blessing too on researchers who are looking for new and improved treatments, and for those who are working so diligently to develop vaccines. This day, we especially remember in our Salem congregation, Anita Lane, Marcy Schuett, Betty Durkin, and Shelley Wolfram. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
This day, we also pray for Bob and Margaret, John and Kathy, Martha, Albertina, Linda. We pray for Barbara's continued recovery from hip surgery this past week, and we pray for Mary Ellen's continued recovery after surgery on her hand this past week. We also lift up to you Gloria Moore after the passing of her sister, Pat Sturgill, and we ask that your presence be with Gloria during this time of grief. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Trusting in your mercy, we commend all for whom we pray. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
And now the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share that sign of peace with our neighbors.
Peace be with you. Peace.
On behalf of both the Faith and Salem congregations, thank you so much for your continued support of our ministries, for your tithes and contributions. If you choose, you can make an offering online at either of our websites, or of course, mail a check in to the congregations. Thank you again.
Let us pray. God of all goodness, generations have turned to you, gathered around your table, and shared your abundant blessings. Number us among them, that as we gather these gifts from your abundance and give thanks for your rich blessings, we may feast upon your very self and care for all that you have made. Through Jesus Christ, our sovereign and servant. Amen.
Let us be so bold as to pray together that wonderful prayer that our Lord Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Receive the blessing. May the God of all creation, in whose image we are made, who claims us and calls us beloved, who strengthens us for service, give you reason to rejoice and be glad. The blessing of God, Sovereign, Savior, and Spirit, be with you today and always. Amen.
Our sending hymn is We've Come This Far by Faith.
Come this far by faith.
Thanks be to God.
Everybody falls sometimes, gotta find the strength to rise from the ashes and make a new beginning. Anyone can feel the ache, you think it's more than you can take, but you're stronger, stronger than you know. Don't you give up now, the sun will soon be shining. You've got to face the clouds to find the silver lining. I've seen dreams that move the mountains, hope that doesn't ever end, even when the sky is falling. I've seen miracles just happen, silent prayers get answered, broken hearts become brand new. gospel is not a word, it's just a reason for someone not to try. And everybody's scared to death when they decide to take that step out on the water. It'll be alright, 'cause life is so much more than what your eyes are seeing. You will find your way if you keep believing. I've seen dreams that move the mountains, hope that doesn't ever end, even when the sky is falling. I've seen miracles just happen, silent prayers get answered, broken hearts become brand new. What faith can do. That's what faith can do. That's what faith can do.